Welcome to the Nonprofit Digital Success Podcast. I'm your host, David, and today I have Scott Miller on the show. Let me preface this by saying that I'm excited about this episode, as it's going to have a little bit of a different take than our usual ones. So allow me to introduce him. Scott knows what it's like to fail. He was demoted from his first leadership position after only 3 weeks, and that's just one of several messy management experiences on his two-decade journey to leadership success. Everyone fails, but something that sets Scott apart in his transparency is willingness to share his story in a way that's forthright, relatable, and applicable. I'm sure you've all been in a position where a project didn't turn out quite how you anticipated. It's just part of learning and growing as an employee. It helps develop a strong character, and owning up to it and taking responsibility makes you a stronger employee, colleague, leader, etc. During his tenure as the CMO at Franklin Covey, he had the opportunity to work with many nonprofit organizations. He also publishes podcasts, webcasts, and best-selling books. I brought Scott on the show because the fundamental principles that govern for-profit businesses also govern nonprofits and charities. He knows a thing or two about branding and leadership, so we're going to dig into that with him today. Scott, thank you so much for being on the show with me today.
David, my honor. Thank you for the spotlight. Excited to have you.
Awesome. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. I think your background is better than mine. So I'm going to tidy mine up a little bit. Nicely done back there. Very colorful.
Thank you.
Which of those books is your favorite book back there? Which one have you read the most times?
So this is a virtual background. So I appreciate, you know, getting called out on that. That's awesome. I've got bookcase sitting over here.
I think it's great marketing. Nice job of actually illustrating the topic today. Nicely done.
There you go. Yeah. So if you're ready, let's jump in and we'll get to it. So, you know, like in my roles in marketing communication teams, I worked in nonprofits for 16 years. It often felt like the rest of the organization was off doing their own thing. And, you know, we were in the dark to a certain extent. It took a lot of time and effort to become part of the conversation instead of just an afterthought like, oh, we need mailings or an email campaign or, you know, we need something on the website. Have you ever experienced that?
Well, no question. I mean, you mentioned earlier that I think the principles that govern organizations are the same principles that govern for-profit or not-for-profit. And the same is, of course, true in the marketing world, whether you're marketing for a multinational global for-profit or a small, you know, local nonprofit. I think the principles are the same. And the principles are aligning your marketing, your branding, your communication with what the top goals of the organization are. I think oftentimes in organizations, even not-for-profits, the goals aren't extremely clear. Perhaps they are to the president or the chairwoman or the, you know, the leader, the director, but in many cases, because it's in your head, does not mean it's in everybody else's head. So I think first and foremost, it's a fundamental leadership principle to make sure that you're communicating what are the top business priorities. And I say business priorities because every organization is either in, they exist to do one of two things, make money or provide a service. It's a universal principle. So if you're in a not-for-profit and you're in marketing, you need to hold your leadership accountable for making sure that they are clearly communicating to you what are the top priorities, fundraising, service, brand, so that you can align all of your activities with theirs. And if they're not clarifying that for you, then you need to call time out and say, I need to get clear on what your top priorities are so that we can align all of our measurement, our initiatives and such with you. And I'd argue, don't blame that on them. Take responsibility for that, because just because you are a leader doesn't mean that you have everything mastered. So as a marketer, it is your responsibility to make sure that you are clarifying exactly what are the top priorities so you can align all your assets to that. And the more you ask smart questions, the more you should be valued. The more you poke and say, so is this like a quarterly goal? Is this an annual goal? How much is this over last year? The more then you can adapt your strategy to it. But if you're living in the vacuum, it's not just the leadership's responsibility, it's yours. You have to maybe move outside your comfort zone and ask questions. And honest to goodness, no question is a dumb question. Because if I know your question is about you gaining clarity, then it's a smart question.
Absolutely. Taking the organizational mission, the goals, the strategy from the top will only help the organization as a whole succeed and grow and achieve their mission.
I would say, David, if I am confused on something, I never put that responsibility on somebody else. I ask more questions. I say, quite courageously, I don't understand what you just said. Could you say that more simply? Or could I try to repeat it back to you in my own words and see if I have it right? I never wallow in confusion. I discuss the undiscussables. I ask questions that others might be embarrassed to ask, because I know that my success is 100% dependent on my understanding of what is the finish line look like? What does success look like? What are we trying to accomplish? And if I'm at all confused on it, then I can't possibly win. But if I'm crystal clear, I'll figure out a way to get it done, or to get the team that I'm leading to get it done.
Absolutely. And, you know, if you're in a room, if you're sitting in a boardroom or just, you know, a stand-up, you know, 15-minute check-in kind of thing, if you're thinking that kind of question, somebody else is also thinking it, right? It's just, you know, who's going to be the one with the guts to ask it and ask for that kind of clarification. That's absolutely huge, for sure. For sure. You know, in terms of nonprofits and charities needing marketing, one of the easiest and often lowest cost or free is social. You know, create a brilliant graphic or short video, and the person responsible for that in the team posts it to, you know, the corporate Facebook page, the feed, the Instagram account and whatnot. But then it gets like one or two clicks or likes, nothing really great. Do you have any recommendations on quick wins that people listening could use as an approach?
Well, so that might be actually counterintuitive, because it's tough to get quick wins in marketing anymore, because there is so much competition for people's wallet, for their brain space. I mean, the amount of information we're all consuming now is just mind-boggling, consciously and subconsciously. It is difficult to get people's attention. And so now more than ever, you're having to test. You're having to calibrate and recalibrate. So I think that social media is an invaluable marketing arrow in your quiver. And I think it's the kind of thing you build over time, just like a database, right? Or any kind of marketing effort. You're not going to place an ad in the New York Times and all of a sudden raise $1 billion off that. You're going to have to repeat it four or five times, or complement with a calling campaign or a direct mail campaign. So first and foremost, I would say, I think that I would challenge the premise of the question, but I'm glad you asked it, because I don't believe much in quick wins in marketing. I think now there's doubt. I've been the CMO of a for-profit company that's, you know, governed by quarterly goals. So I get the need to have results in 90 days. And I've been measured by 90-day increments for 30 years in my career. So it isn't like I think I've got, you know, 9 months to create success on something. Social media is something that builds over time. I think the bigger question to ask, David, is, sure, are you on the right platform? You know, based upon your not-for-profit, should you be on Instagram? Should you be on LinkedIn? Should you be on TikTok? Should you be on Pinterest? I mean, honestly, Clubhouse, right? Where should you be? How are you building your followers? How are you building your connections? Are you every day creating new followers? Are you adding value through engagement? You know, ask yourself every day, do I have a cadence? Am I posting, you know, once every 4 days, so it's episodic? Am I posting every 5 hours? Is there value in what I'm posting? Is there benefit to click on what I'm posting? I think there's lots of things that can be small tweaks with big changes. I'm consulting with a client right now, and in their social, their salespeople, it's a for-profit company, they post, you know, marketing brochures, what we call slip sheets in corporate America. The font is like, you know, 9 on the page, it's 2 on social media. Like, who is going to read that? I'm not going to read that. Are you kidding me? I'm going to scroll and read it. So, well, why not create a, you know, 30-second video and talk about what's in that, or what's the big idea? So the fundamental principles with social are cadence, value. Are you on the right platform for your customers are? I think the biggest question I would ask is, what is the purpose? Are you trying to raise money? Are you trying to provide more services? Are you trying to show your funders that you're actually serving their needs by communicating? What's the purpose of your social media? And then cater your strategy to align with that purpose. Because your strategy to raise money might be very, very different than you wanted to showcase how you're deploying the dollars you have raised to your funders. Might be different than trying to find, you know, people to provide services to. Get really clear on, why are you using it? And are you communicating value to those who should be listening? It's like anything. Most people think about the total addressable market. I think the best marketers resist that temptation. They think about the smallest viable market. Who are the people that we're really looking to gain the attention of, and how can we message to them and our social media? You cannot be all things to all people.
Yeah, you know, taking that one step further, you know, aligning your goals in terms of outreach on social with your organization's mission would also help clarify, you know, identifying where your audience is going to be sitting for any given specific type of campaign that you're trying to run.
Beautifully said. I would take it one step further. I think most of us marketers get sucked in to the gravitational pull of our organization, our mission, our purpose, our needs, our budget. And I remind everybody watching and listening that that's a temptation every marketer faces. And that many cases, you have to be the lone resisting voice to know, well, so what are our funders need? What are the people that are providing, receiving our services need? You need to ask the question, what is the circumstance our clients are in? I use the word clients because even not-for-profits have clients, right? Whether they are individual customers or individual consumers of your service or product, what is the circumstance they are in? Get really clear on it. And that's what you should message to. It might be, what is the circumstance that our benefactor is in? And you might be really clear. It is, you know, it is six-figure lawyers that are interested in legal justice. It might be people that are afflicted with a similar illness, and they've been able to cure their illness, or you've helped them. So who are the other people suffering from that? But when you understand the circumstance that your buyers, your clients, your consumers, your benefactors are in, then you message to them and have their goals more in mind than yours. Requires a bit of courage and resisting the hairball of your organization and be outwardly focused.
Absolutely. Getting the buy-in, putting yourself in the shoes of the people that you're trying to communicate with and have view things from their standpoint will help you create that emotional connection, right? And, you know, emotion drives majority of decision-making, right? So where they want to spend their donor dollars, where they want to spend their time volunteering, it all kind of like pulls that all together.
Repetition over time, right? I mean, you're not going to launch a social media campaign and then, you know, 4 days think you're going to impact people's, you know, behavior. You know, it used to be where you had thought conventionally a decade ago that you had to have 4 or 5 impressions to, you know, move someone to behavior. And then it went to like 7 to 8. And now I hear it's more than 15. Like, someone needs to see your product, your brand, your service, your message, your plea in excess of 15 times before they are perhaps moved to action. That might mean some direct mail. It might be some sponsorship. It might be some social media. It might be an advertisement on a digital site or in a print magazine. But it does take more to gain people's attention because everyone is so distracted now.
Absolutely. And that leads right into, I guess, my next question, which is, you know, in terms of learning from marketing efforts to produce effective content, what type of metrics would you suggest people consider as part of their marketing plans? And, you know, a lot of people often don't do this, but like a post-mortem review afterwards to talk about, you know, what worked, what didn't work, that type of thing.
Right. In this book that I wrote called Marketing Mess to Brand Success, I dedicated a whole chapter to the value of a postmortem. So I think it's extraordinarily valuable at the end of a campaign to sit down and open the kimono. And the leader has to start first. The leader has to start with, well, whose idea was that? Oh, that was my idea. Sorry, that was pretty bad, wasn't it? I mean, you have to make it safe for other people to be owning their mistakes as well, right? Or in the wins as well too. So it's important the postmortem is dealing in facts and reality. It's all safe. It is what it is. What can we learn from this? What not to do and what to do? Your first question was around metrics. This may sound convenient, David, but they're going to change based on every campaign and organization. You might be in a fundraising mode. So you might be choosing to measure lead activities as well as lag activities. I think a lot of marketers fall into the mistake of having a scoreboard. We need to raise $100,000 during this campaign. And you think you have to track it every week, which you do, by the way. But more importantly than tracking your progress is to track your lead measures. What types of things can we influence? What types of things can we change or pivot on? Not just, you know, how much did we raise last week may or may not be an indicator of what we'll raise this week. So you want to be thoughtful around identifying your lead measures, things you can influence, and your lag measures, things that are perhaps in your rearview mirror versus your, you know, or your back window versus your front window. But your metrics are going to change. Here's what I would do, though. If you're leading marketing, you must make sure that what you are tracking is what is valuable to the operations or the business side of your organization, including if you're a not-for-profit, right? If you have a fundraising goal, if you have a communication goal, you want to make sure that you're tracking the things that are valued from your leader as well. Because you might be tracking, like you said it earlier, you know, number of likes. You might come back and say, we've got 38,000 likes on these 12 posts. Well, that doesn't translate into meeting your goal. It's immaterial and you look disconnected. So I would argue that you should co-craft your critical success factors, co-craft your measurements with the business side of the foundation, right? To make sure, or the leadership side, to make sure that you're tracking the right things and have the willingness and the courage to course correct midway through. We often track the wrong things, right? Early out in campaigns, for profit, not for profit. We think we know what our lead indicators. We realize, oh, actually, that's not working. What we should track is this instead, because that's leading to a conversion. So don't be afraid to demonstrate humility and change your mind midway through. I think the best leaders, the best marketing leaders, are those that can balance their confidence with humility and be able to pivot and turn on a dime.
Yeah, and you know, the last 18, 19 months has definitely, you know, led to, okay, well, how are we going to survive this? How, as an organization, are we going to be able to pivot, as you say, and, you know, stay viable as an organization to continue to serve our community, serve the greater good, help, et cetera, et cetera. So I think that was, you know, spot on for sure. You know, inevitably, a few times a year when we meet with our clients, we're asked if we should produce some kind of collateral as digital only or print only or a combination. Think about something like an annual report, right? So what are your thoughts on digital versus print for publications?
You know, one of the chapters that I write about is the responsible resurgence of print. And so I think it's, again, all about knowing the circumstance, knowing your market, right? If you're not for profit focused on environmental impact, I think it would be probably lunacy to create a print report, unless that made sense and it was on, you know, the right paper and it was only 6 pages versus last year's 70 pages. I mean, and I would be asking questions of your audience. How would you feel if we were to produce this year's annual report and a printed document because of how much digital confusion there is with clutter and inboxes? And what if we were to present it, you know, on this or that or the other, or we were to plant trees to offset it? Just, you know, make sure you think through what are the unintended consequences. It might be horrifying if at your annual meeting, you pass out a printed guidebook and everybody's wondering, are you kidding me? How tone deaf are you? Or it might be the right thing to do because you wanted to illustrate some things that otherwise could not be viscerally felt in a presentation. So first, I think there's no wrong or right answer as long as you've asked all the right questions. I think a lot of marketing campaigns go sideways because things are built in a vacuum. Then all of a sudden you've built this beautiful inner report and you realize your biggest benefactor is the Audubon Society or is someone who's extremely into, you know, preservation of trees or the ozone layer. You get the point, right? So just, you got to know your audience and make sure you're not asking questions in a vacuum. Get out of your office, go out and talk to some of your customers, to your funders, and ask them what their opinion is. I think there's a great place for print. Here's a good example. As an author, you can see behind me, I've written numerous best-selling books. I speak for a living. I'm on the road continuously speaking. My books are consumed probably in 60% print, about 25% audio, and 10% digital. When I speak, I never use PowerPoint. What I do is I take this book and I turn it into a card deck that I'm sharing now on the screen for those of you that perhaps aren't watching. So all of the 30 challenges in my book are created in a card deck that I pass out in the audience. Now, some might think that that's not, you know, environmentally sensitive, and that might be true in that moment, but I'm also in business. And as soon as that PowerPoint is done, I'm done in that person's mind. But this person is taking my PowerPoint back with them. be able to use it in a meeting. You're able to say, well, here was a great principle. Let's talk about this. You can't do that with a PowerPoint you're never going to see again. So there are times when converting your content, your service, your product into something that hits the client where they need it to be. I think it's all about knowing your audience and moving outside of your own group think to make sure that you have validated the upside and the downside of using different types of media. I mean, I can send out 8 million emails. 7.5 million will never get to the person because of their clutter and their spam and their company controls. You're quote, pissing in a hurricane. I'm sorry for the lack of delicacy there. Make sure you are thinking through your campaigns and you're thinking of all of the intended and unintended consequences of having it be effective. It might be the best thing to actually have a print piece of direct mail and to say a tree was planted for every 10 of these to offset and to protect our... It's good. Thanks for that. That's nice.
Yeah, you know, like you said before, it's a matter of connecting with the end person, right? Connecting with who it is on the end of it that's going to be receiving it and making sure that it matches with their principles.
I think the marketing campaigns that flop is usually because they're tone deaf. I'll repeat this. As a chief marketing officer of a global public company, it's not good enough just to cook it up in your office with your team, go pitch it to the executive team, and then launch it. You got to take it out to the field. You got to go out to who all your constituents are and ask them, do you like this? How would this feel if I show you this, right? I mean, I've never had to pull something back because I didn't launch a TV campaign or create a billboard and all of a sudden had to take it down because it was tone deaf. I'm actually shocked at sometimes how these big brands have to take down commercials or campaigns because they offended a huge section of the audience by misappropriating someone's cultural heritage or, you know, something in English means this in Mandarin, right? And you get the point. You've got to get out there and kind of field test it to the best of your ability to make sure you don't find yourself in an embarrassing situation.
Yeah, it can be definitely tough to dig out from that when
every
it does
day.
Happen.
Tougher right? to dig out. And it's even tougher to predict. You're like, that's a thing? That would offend someone? That never crossed my mind. But then you realize, oh my gosh, that's a thing. And I was ignorant of it. And my intentions weren't that, but you've got to get out there and ask more people. You could probably over vet your campaign because someone's going to have a problem with everything, right? There's going to be a problem. You know, you're going to have some people that could not ever imagine having water in a plastic jug. Other people buy it by the caseload because they've got 7 kids and the water in their community is, you know your audience and get outside your comfort zone and ask people, how would you feel about this? Invaluable feedback.
Absolutely, for sure. You touched on this a little bit a moment ago. Many organizations rely on email marketing, be it for fundraising or getting their message out there, events. In your book, Marketing Mess to Brand Success, you talk about net phishing versus spear phishing. Can you cast a line into that and explain the difference and how nonprofits could use such a technique?
Yeah, there's kind of a marketing adage that says every marketing campaign needs to have 3 components. The quality of your list, the quality of your creative, and the quality of your offer. It used to be the conventional wisdom, David, was a third, a third, and a third. A quality of your list, the quality of your creative, meaning you know, how creative is your coupon or your ad or whatever it is, and the quality of your offer, 60% off, buy one, get 3 free, whatever it is, right? Donate to this and get a free hat, whatever it is. Now I think it's probably 80% the quality of your list, 10% the quality of your offer, and 10% the quality of your creative. Because list is everything. Lists tend to churn about 35% a year. So if you have a list that is 3 years old, it's 100% obsolete. The average tenure of someone at their job now is 18 months. People are now changing careers, companies, every 18 months. And so I think it is an obsession of every marketer to make sure that you have the quality of your list as your number one job. It is the least validating. It is the least fun. It is the least sexy. It's the least creative. You don't go home at night showing your spouse or partner, look at the quality of my list. You want to go home and show them your social, you know, card, right? Or your direct mail piece or the ad and the piece. Yeah, that's fun. The best marketers recognize that a lot of marketing isn't fun. A lot of marketing is behind the scenes grunt work to painstakingly build lists, whether you rent them or you buy them, whether you build them in-house the old-fashioned way by going on Google or LinkedIn and find, you know, just so happens that, you know, people that have recovered from breast cancer are most likely to donate to breast cancer. I'm making that up. I'm guessing there probably is some logic to that. And go out and find, to the extent you can, with, you know, with regulations and such, how do you carefully curate your list? Because your email is only effective as the quality of your list. And, you know, with spam filters and what is the law in Canada?
It's called CASEL.
CASEL, right? You have to be super careful about protecting people's privacy and not having someone, you know, choose to make an example out of you because you haven't had the right opt-out buttons or the right opt-in or all of that. And so I generally am not a huge fan of email anymore. I don't know about you. I get 400 emails a day just in my corporate email box. I get another 125 in my business box. I probably get about 30 LinkedIn messages a day. I probably get 10 Facebook messages, 20 or 30 Instagram messages, and probably what, 75 to 80 inbound texts a day. Email is the last place I go because most of it gets caught in a filter and goes to trash. So I don't mean to relegate email. I still think there is value in it. But with the advent of marketing automation, where now you can load up your email into a HubSpot or a Marketo or an Eloqua and send out 9 emails that all make it look like I'm your best friend, everybody is wise to that. Delete, 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 delete. I think marketing automation has probably been a curse in many ways to the efficacy of email. So be thoughtful about where it fits in your mix, but know that the quality of your database is much more important than everything else. There are science around the subject line, right? That's important. But I would just ask you, does our audience respond to email? It may not be. And if it does, when should I send it? Because if your audience is C-suite staff, I'd say send it at 5 o'clock in the morning. Because that's when most C-suite is starting their day and she's into her email and she might come in and has a good subject line and it's the fourth one she's gotten in 3 weeks and it's added some value to her. She might choose to click on it and move a bit forward. But make sure that you're catering your email to the circumstance that your intended audience is in. That was a long answer. Sorry.
That's brilliant advice. Absolutely. You know, hit them where they want to be hit. And it's a constant message through everything that you're saying, right? Like take into account who you're dealing with, who your audience is.
Right. Because a lot of email marketers will publish an email calendar, right? The best time is Tuesdays at 4 o'clock. Not for a CEO. Best time for a CEO is probably Monday at 4 a.m. Because if you're a CEO, you've been thinking about your business all night long, most cases, and you're in early in the saddle and you're pulling up your email from your phone as you're having a cup of coffee at 4:35 in the morning before you go to your trainer, before you do your meditation, whatever it is, you need to know what is the lifestyle that people are trying to hit and do your best to navigate into that.
Yeah, just today, every handful of days, I take a look in my spam just to make sure, you know, there wasn't anything important that got caught in there. And I went in there today. I wish I would have kept this email so I could read it. But just in terms of like email automation, it was some random spam about, oh, you know, we'll redo your website. They sent it to me, right? So they haven't obviously seen that that's what, you know, Wow Digital actually does. But it said something in there like, oh, we're in the midst of June. And, you know, by the end of July, we'll have a website redone for you. And I'm like, it's October. Today's October 20th. I don't know when we're going to necessarily air this episode. It might be in a couple of weeks from now. Yeah. But like, come on. If you're sending out messages, you need to make sure that it's on point.
That's right. And I think people are starting to get wise to these emails that feign a level of familiarity and connection. And I think it's kind of tipped a point also. I don't want to dismiss email. Like I won't dismiss direct mail. It's a component of your plan, the surround sound of your marketing. And every single one of these, your team should be asking yourselves, how would we use this? How will this reinforce and complement our overall strategy? Don't put your entire budget into renting 9 million emails when in fact, that might not be the right way to put your firepower, your magic, your genius in front of your intended audience. Everything should be scrutinized and thought about and tested and measured and post-mortem, to quote you earlier. And it's like, was that a good thing? Should that be no longer a strategy, or should we minimize that strategy and put our time elsewhere? Marketing is, gosh, you know, next to technology, marketing is probably the most agile and nimble industry that's changing constantly.
As technology evolves, as it does, right? And as people's workplaces evolve, right? This last year or so has definitely, you know, made a change with that. So does, you know, how people deal with communications.
At the end of the day, the most powerful marketing is word of mouth referrals. At the end of the day, you know, you can send me an email, ask me to come to your fundraiser. You can send me a direct mail. I still get mail in my mailbox. I get 15 pieces of mail every single day. I walk out to my mailbox and I look at it. I don't get any email on my corporate job because that ended 18 months ago. I haven't seen a piece of mail from my company 18 months. I guarantee you there are thousands of gift baskets and apples and Viewmasters and calendars and journals all piling up at my corporate email address, like the other millions of people that have or haven't been back to the company 3 times in a year. Or perhaps we are, we're not walking down, the mail cart isn't coming around the building anymore, the world has changed. But if David sends me a text and say, hey, I'm really passionate about this cause, would you be willing to buy a $60 ticket to come to our gala next week? I'm like, yeah, I'll come, you got it. Don't ever underestimate the power of human connection, relationships, and referrals to drive interest in your enterprise, profit or not for profit.
Absolutely.
I mean, here's a good example. My wife and I send our boys to private school in Salt Lake City. We pay our property tax, which funds public schools. There was a big gala a few weeks ago for the public schools. We don't put our kids in public schools. Although we didn't go to it, we donated to it. We gave something for the silent auction because a friend of ours asked us to. Had they been emailing me, they clearly don't have a good list because they don't realize my children aren't enrolled in public school. But it was right. The power of someone calling me that knew me and asking me for that. And I still think that that's the most valuable marketing, is the relationships and people leveraging their network on your behalf.
Absolutely. Earlier on, you touched on something called smallest viable market. So what does that mean? And, you know, what does that mean to nonprofits?
You know, earlier you asked me the question around net fishing and spear phishing. This is a good time, I think, to answer that. Is metaphorically what a lot of people do because they're lazy or don't know better is they just cast their net out to everything, everyone, right? Let's get the biggest email database we can, whether or not they may or may not be interested in helping children suffering from this type of, you know, ailment. And they scoop up everything. They scoop up, they're looking for grouper. They scoop up grouper, but they also scoop up a tire and a chain link fence. They scoop up an alligator. They scoop up a hose. You get the point, right? That's kind of net fishing. There probably is a time and a place for that. I can't think of one. And there is spear fishing. And that is, we're going after grouper. And perhaps it's a bit macabre now, but you're now going out in your boat to where the grouper feed, right? And you're very carefully taking your spear and you're going after the grouper one by one. It takes more time. It's not as fun. It takes more effort. Takes more research and preparation, takes thinking and listening and being quiet and looking. These are fundamental marketing principles. And I think it supports well your current question, which is smallest viable market. The best marketers in the world will tell you that entrepreneurs, business owners, leaders of not-for-profits, it's the same principle. Don't try to go after everybody. Everybody is not your customer. Everybody is not your benefactor. Everybody is not your donor. Figure out what is the circumstance they are in and go after the first one. If you're going after parents who are passionate about reading, I'm your guy. You're trying to fund a mobile bookmobile for an underserved committee, you need $1,000, bring it on. I'm your guy. I love reading. We have thousands of books in my house. I'm a passionate about literacy. And then I'll go tell someone. Then who is your next customer? It's your smallest viable market versus your total addressable market. And it's counterintuitive because everyone thinks bigger is better and more is better. It's not true. Find out who are the Scott Millers that are passionate about literacy and go after them. And by the way, I know that most organizations think they want more customers. You don't. You want the fewest number of customers you need. You might need 2 donors. You might need 4 donors. You might need 40. You might not need 4,000. Now, I recognize the fewer you have, the more important they are and the riskier there is if they fall out. So you have to ask all those questions. But I think to ask yourself is, if we could get by with only 8 donors, who would they be? What are their names? Where do they live? Where do they shop? Where do they eat? What do they do? Go after those, and then your circle will resonate. Because people who are passionate about literacy like me, I'll call up all my friends and say, I got the coolest thing ever. Listen to this. This is a mobile bookmobile serving the urban community, teaching young kids that never been in a library before the power of reading. Let's have a dinner for them. Everybody, donate $100. Come over to my house. Let's have dinner. And I'm raised, before you know it, I've raised $4,000 and you haven't spent a single penny because you've spent the time identifying the smallest viable market about a person who has a passion on what you do. This might be elementary, but I think the next generation of marketing needs to go back to these principles as opposed to getting hooked up with just the digital aspect of marketing. At the end of the day, you're trying to get Scott Miller's attention, who has passion around your cause. And the best way to do that is to come tug on my heart. Speak my language.
It goes back to the motion. And in with regards to marketing, a lot of people think about demographics. Very few, like really very few, think about psychographics and really digging into the psyche of the person you want to connect and what their beliefs are. What, you know, Scott, he's into books, he's into literacy. He wants to make sure people are able to think for themselves and learn new things, right? How can we connect with them and with the Scott Millers of the community to have them believe in our cause and help support? So I think that's definitely key.
If you're raising money for rugby, I'm not your guy, right? If you're raising money for people with speech impediments, I'm your guy. Lifelong stutterer. Four times of braces, Invisalign, headgear, retainer, speech pathologist, speech therapist, speech coaches, I'm your guy. You've got to figure out who is your smallest viable market. If someone came to me tomorrow, asked me to help them fund a program around, you know, speech therapy for children with, I would be like, where is my checkbook? I'm all over it. Show me your program, right? I'm passionate about this. This is not new to not-for-profits, but don't lose track of this. This is your key focus.
Yeah. And, you know, the next thing I'd like to talk about is there's many organizations out there that are vying for people's money and for their checks. And a lot of them, not a lot, but, you know, for every organization, there's at least a handful that are doing the same kind of work, maybe in a different region of the country or a different country altogether. So in terms of, you talk about friending your competition, how would that apply for a nonprofit?
Yeah, so this is a business principle that I applied in the book. I think it's a good lifelong principle for many years, decades. In the corporate world, you kind of demonized your competition. You sold against them, right? Well, here are their weaknesses, and I'm just still beyond that in life. I generally detest the tearing down of people, whether it be from political leaders, whether it be from community leaders. I generally detest the politics of hate and division. I detest the cancel culture. And I think this relates to this point, which is you can learn a lot from your competition. Go to lunch with them. What are you finding valuable? What are you finding is your sweet spot? How can we complement you? Are we going after the same donors? Should we have our campaigns at different times of the year? You know, so how can we work together to have Scott give both to public schools and for literacy programs and for, you know, speech impediments? And I would. So I think there's a lot to be learned from your competition. Is email working for them? Are they finding that the gala is right? How do you have a virtual gala? What's happening with this? How are you pivoting? I think most leaders have an abundance mindset, especially not-for-profit leaders, because they've chosen to dedicate their lives to these valuable missions. And by the very nature of their own legacies, they're not scarce. They are abundant. Now, they're smart. They realize there's only so much philanthropy to go around or only so much, you know, we get that. I'm not a Pollyanna. But I think generally having a spirit of abundance by allowing you to talk with your complementary or perhaps even competitive other organizations, get together and maybe You sequence your campaigns and on top of each other. Maybe you talk about what is working for you. You're probably not sharing all the same lists, because if you're focused on your smallest viable market and you're spearfishing, you're probably not in competition with them for the same person. So I do think, generally speaking, this should hit a sweet spot with your listeners, because by the very nature of the countenance of your listeners being a not-for-profit, they're very mission-driven and they have an abundance mindset. There probably isn't a scarce bone in their body. So you might rethink the lens through which you look at your competition and how could you collaborate versus seeing them as a threat.
Yeah, I mean, your passion for marketing and really digging in and getting to, you know, the heart of what will help people drive to see you, to be part of the organization, to be part of your mission and your goals. You know, whether it's for business, we're talking a lot about nonprofit, but, you know, your passion is so great. This has been so enlightening. You know, I've taken away some amazing tidbits that I can definitely take back to my clients. So thank you very much. And I hope the people listening today have been able to get some great advice and pointers from you. If anybody wanted to get in touch with you, what do they need to do?
Sure. So the book that I've been drawing upon from the last less than an hour is Marketing Mess to Brand Success. It was a number one Amazon new release. You can buy it on all your favorite book sites or retailers. You can visit me at scottjeffreymiller.com. I host what is the world's largest weekly leadership podcast. It hits about 7 million every Tuesday. So you can subscribe to my podcast in addition to David's as well. You can connect to me on every social platform. I'm there as well. I'd be honored to have any of your listeners, that they found the concepts of our discussion valuable. I think they will find Marketing Mess to Brand Success full of funny, relevant, some horrifying marketing mistakes that I've made, but to learn from my marketing messes in the hopes to improve your brand successes.
That's amazing. Thanks again for joining in, Scott. It's been great having you on the Nonprofit Digital Success Podcast, a much smaller podcast than yours is. And to everybody listening, if you want any of the links or resources that Scott provided, his contact info, et cetera, just head over to our podcast page at wowdigital.com/podcast and click on this episode for all the details. Until the next episode, keep on being successful. Thanks.